this information, can we put it in a different format? So we have to step back, okay? So if somebody comes and asks, is the water contaminated? Is the water safe to drink? Then your answer cannot be, your absolute final answer can be, okay, give me a month's time. I will analyze whether it contains all the 1 lakh chemicals that we know that exist in nature, and then I will tell you in a month's time. That's not acceptable, right? People won't wait for that long. So you need a quick answer. What is a quick answer? A quick answer can never be a detailed answer. It has to be a short answer, but it gives you partial information. Whether you, so we do, whenever we do such things, we need a quick answer. We need what is called as a screening. Screening. We do a preliminary analysis. We say, is this good or bad? Now this is a very. It's not a very. From a scientific or rational point of view, you know that the answer could be wrong, but at least you have some sense of what is happening, what is there, and whether where you should put your these things. Okay. So from a screening point of view. This is when we get to the classification of what are pollutants, what kind of, where we should put our efforts in. So screening, for water quality, how would you screen a water sample? By just looking at it, can you screen a water sample? Keep in mind all the discussion we had in the previous slide, talked about chemicals and all that. But when we look at water quality itself, what do you look for? So our water quality, again, when somebody gives you a water sample, so what is the first question you ask them when somebody says, please tell me if it is good water? So your question, what is your follow-up question? If somebody says, tell me something about water quality, what should be your question, return question? Good for? Good for what? The question is good for what?
Drinking.
Drinking. So drinking is the most, the highest quality because you are concerned about that. So if you say, you have to specify that. This is again related to economics and the resource we have. Because if we have, we are seeing that problem now everywhere. We want drinking water. We want drinking water quality. The amount of water that we drink is not the same as the amount of water we use for washing or some other purposes. Then we have to decide whether we use the effort to clean up the water to that extent. So drinking water, what will you look for in drinking water? When somebody gives you a glass of water, when will you not drink the glass of water? If it is colored, if it is, it is turbid, which means it is not clear. Colored, it is clear, but it is not colorless, it is something. Then smells, or we call it as odor. It smells, you, it looks clean, it looks clear, but it smells, something is smelling. Yeah. Then all these three are good, then you take it in your mouth, it does not taste good. Beyond this, these are visible parameters. You quickly know that, suppose it is none of this above, if you drink it, you can still, there could still be something in the water which does not give any of these. But these are very good, preliminary screening factors, okay. You could have a quantitative aspect to this, which means you could, what does it color? Color means what could be there in the water. It's not turbid, it's clean, it's clear, but it is colored. What could be a chemical? In what form and what? So it's a chemical that is usually the definition that we give is dissolved, it's dissolved. So you have to make very clear distinction between a few things here. Dissolved is, it is in the structure of the water and everything, it does not form a precipitate. Dissolved, clean, clear. Salt water, for example, if you dissolve salt or sugar, it is dissolved. You will see a clear solution, okay, which means it is dissolved, it is chemically dissolved, okay. turbid is not dissolved. The technical term that we use for this is suspended solids. Something is suspended, which means it just floats in the water. Odor is also dissolved because this you can't see it, but you can smell it. But it is volatilizing, it is getting out of water slowly, that is an indicator. Taste, which also means it is dissolved. So, you have a bunch of things that can be there in the water which are either suspended or dissolved, that is all, two states, okay. So, there are variety of chemicals. So, in water there are chemicals have a wide range of solubilities. They can dissolve to different extents in the water, okay. So, we will come to those properties. So, we are looking at a large number of chemicals which have, which may be present in the water in a dissolved state, yeah. So, which of the compounds are important from a dissolved point of view, which are likely to have higher solubilities? Which compounds are likely to have a high solubility in water? Organic or inorganic? Make a guess. Inorganic mostly. Ions, things like ions, they form solution in water. So, a large number of inorganic salts, ions, they have a very high solubility in water. You can also have organic compounds which are dissolved in water, but organic compounds by nature, organic compounds, there is a classification of chemicals here that makes it important. So, for example, a compound that has a classification, a structure that looks like this, C, and hydrogen here and here and so on. By definition, these kind of compounds, many of these compounds which have a very large number of C's do not like water. They do not have high solubility in water. If you look at the data of solubility versus the number of carbons, it is usually decreasing with the number of carbons as you go. But if you have a group here, say I have a compound with an OH group or a COOH group or an NH2 or some such thing, or even chlorine sometimes, some of these have higher solubility in water than something that does not have H. But still these compounds are not, in comparison to inorganic salts, their solubility is very low. So, there is one thing that you have to understand straight away, that many of these organic compounds also have solubility, all of them have solubilities. It is just low, just water does not like water, but it can be present in water. Okay, we will look at that. This is the first assignment that I will give to you, is a chemical property assignment, where you have to look at a bunch of chemicals, different classifications, and then find out properties and then analyze the properties and what it means. So, there is this term which is called as hydrophobicity. We will come back to this term later. The context of this is not with the, in the solubility, it is something else. So, it is relative, okay. Anyway, so organic compounds also can be present, there is a finite solubility, but this is larger. So, this one, the solubility is very large, much larger than that of organic compound, okay. So, what about suspended solids? What do you think are there in suspended solids? What is the classification, what type of material can be suspended in water, which means it is not dissolving. It is an insoluble precipitate compound that does not dissolve in water, but it can be suspended. Which are all, can you give any examples of what all can be, are the materials that you can just suspend? Detergent, no, detergent are soluble at some concentrations as a different class. Detergents are very different. Detergent will suspend. If I change amount of water, it will all become dissolved. It depends on concentration. As once you change concentration, it will dissolve. But this will not dissolve. Suspended solids won't dissolve under any condition. They are chemically, they are not, they cannot dissolve in water. Okay. So this does not matter how much water you have or you add anything else, they are suspended. Unless you destroy them or remove it out of it. Somebody said something else? Carbonate. What is carbonate? What is the form? What kind of so these are precipitates, these are insoluble precipitates. There are some salts which are insoluble, so those are present. There are some oxides which are insoluble, so those are present. And there is all components that we discussed in soil yesterday, sand, silt, clay, they are all there. They are all part of the suspended. There is one other group of suspended particles we have not discussed in the class so far. What is that? Which imparts turbidity to water, but it is not part of the inorganic list of inorganic chemicals you just mentioned. You mentioned insoluble salts, precipitates, sand, silt, clays, all these are there. There is one other group of suspended particle, suspended matter that can, that will constitute part of suspended solids. No, this is plastics is all new, microplastics and all that. We are talking about something traditionally there. What will you do if you do not do any of these things to water? If I give you a clear sample of water, then you know, if you see a turbid sample of water, what do you normally do for water to before you drink it? Yeah? What is the minimum that you will do to water filter then? Boil. Sometimes filtration itself will work. You do not need boiling. What does that mean? So whatever you are boiling for is there in the filterable part also. So what is that? What compound, what is the entity we are trying to remove or destroy? Microbes. So microorganisms also, they are organisms. They have a certain size. They are floating, different size depending on what form they are in. So again we are doing a lot of classification. We are again, the length is increasing, the list is increasing. We have microbes, we have sand, silt, clay and all these things. Okay. So here we have one group that can be dissolved, another group that is suspended. Very simply, the water quality itself you can classify it now as, if you measure the total dissolved components and the total suspended components, this you will get a very simple classification straight away. So one of the water quality parameters is, we call it as total dissolved solids. See, the word solids is a very, it's a misnomer here. It's not an insoluble solid, it's a solid. People have used this term it is called as TDS, and the other one is total suspended solids. TSS. So we look at, I will just finish up in just a minute. Total dissolved solids, normally it is inorganic plus organic. Yeah. But we know that in compounds, in most of the water samples, this dominates. This is very high, as we have already seen. The strict definition of total dissolved solid is everything, it's organic, inorganic, everything together. Okay. But because inorganic dominates, we disregard the organic part wherever it is suitable. Because if you are able to measure inorganic very easily, usually the we approximate this TDS to total inorganic, total dissolved inorganic. what that does is, the way you measure total dissolved inorganics is very different from where you measure organic dissolved and inorganic total completely. So if you make this assumption that this is approximately same as this, which means this part is very negligible, I can't measure it compared, then this TDS becomes a very simple measurement. It's an easy way to measure it. Okay. So,